All right, ready when you are.
I'm Cole.
I'm Rafael.
And this summer, we spent the summer looking for a method of identifying the accuracy of models of the index refraction at the Antarctic. So first, explain some physics background so you understand what we're talking about. First, the index refraction is a portion of the speed of light of vacuum divided by the speed of light through the medium. So it gives you the index refraction of that medium. Action is the difference between potential kinetic energy of a particle. And the principle of least action states particles traveling from one point to another will take the path that minimizes the total action. And so why that's important is in a medium of differing index refraction, for instance, Antarctic ice, as you go down, the index refraction increases, which means a light particle traveling from here to here won't take a straight path, or in fact, will take a more curved path like this, a path given by something called the Fermat. And then, they have Huygens' construction. Well, Huygens' construction says that, for instance, you have a source of light and it emits light, and the light comes out as a sphere. This is due to the fact that each point of light on the sphere also acts as another source of light, and they destructively interfere everywhere else on the sphere. And normally, if we just have light propagating through a vacuum or constant index refraction medium, that doesn't matter because it will always come out as a sphere. But if you have a medium like an Arctic ice where the index of refraction changes in depth and you have light coming out of these curves, each point of light on here will act as another source of light. And thus, you'll get a region compared to here where you'll have light destructively interfering, which is known as a shadow zone or a shadow region. And in that zone, you'll either get a reduced signal or no signal at all, depending on the level of shadow. But why do we care about the index of refractive ice in the Antarctic? And it's because the Antarctic acts as a huge cosmic ray detector. Neutrinos are very light particles that rarely interact with matter, let alone very not dense matter like air. And the Antarctic ice is dense and radio quiet, which means when a neutrino interacts with something in the Antarctic ice, it'll release a radio shower, and we can detect without much interference, and we get a denser shower than neutrino interactions in the air. And an accurate index refraction profile, the function for how index of refraction changes in depth, is important so we have effective antenna placement. Here's an example of a model of index of refraction, and you notice it's asymptotic. You get diminishing returns on index of refraction. Now, if money were no object, every time you stick an antenna into Antarctic ice, you'd always just stick it right down at the asymptotic index of refraction, and it'd be good. But because we care about money, money very much is an object, we need to balance. The reason you stick it down lower is the higher the index of refraction, the less shadow you get, the more signal you pick up. So we need to balance how deep we put our antenna to avoid shadowing versus the cost of drilling down that deep. And to get an accurate measure of that, we need to have an accurate model of an index of refraction. And that's what the R experiment is, the neutrino detector zone and the Antarctic that detects radio shower. And Raphael will explain how we check the accuracy index of refraction profile.
So first off, there is a third person on our group, Craig, who helped out with the first initial project. And the initial stage was Cole, Craig, and I, we as humans analyzed by eye all of the pulses in our data. And when I refer to pulses, I refer to the fact that when a signal travels through this experiment, there's a transmitter, a receiver, and the transmitter sends two signals. One diverges off in a longer reflective path, reflected off the surface of the ice, and one came into a direct path. Since this direct path was shorter and the reflective path was longer, the pulses that were generated had a big initial pulse, some time passing with somewhat radio silence, and then lesser secondary pulse into a reflective. So we went by eye, measuring the points where it started, the peak. gave the data to me for my crude model, which somewhat made itself. And after two failures, I just essentially asked over the system that I needed. And he eventually finished off, refined everything, ironed out whatever problems I was having, and created many graphs that indicated what we had. And we compared what was observed through the sheets themselves, and then we also compared what we got out through the model. Here we have the difference between that. Here, the first graph up to the left is the actual time itself in between pulses. And the red is predicted what the model came out of, and green is the observed one that we had. Here, both of them intertwine pretty well. It's a straight up, it's a increasing linear path as expected. And onto the right is the difference between predicted and, between observed and predicted. And we were hoping for zero, so that it's nearly on par on top. 20 was an on par, but as it goes up further, zero on top right there. Most of the data points converged right there at that point.
Now, can you just remind people what the horizontal axis corresponds to these plots?
Here on this horizontal axis. So as we go further down to the cross, it's a function of depth, so that we would go further deeper into it. So further down in the eye to go, further down the receiver is. Way down further down the transmitter is, that's the depth that we have taken in here. And the same on the other one right there. So each data point is just the receiver, but this transmitter being dropped down lower and lower into the core.
And the receiver, is it more depth? More depth is into the receiver?
The receivers are all in their unique depths based on their channel.
Okay. I don't remember what it all. We have that information. I just don't remember it all. Yeah.
So you don't remember what channel this is?
This is channel
50.
So at some point, some of the channels were off, and then we just talked this up. So here, at the beginning stages of 0 to around 80, it looked somewhat stable. It looked as if it was a bit laggy, but it's still actually. And then the data set that we observed went straight down. And it's maybe talked about the fact that further down you go, the more it's
And a possible cause to that error is our graphs were organized by D depth. So the last graphs we analyzed were the graphs with greatest D depth, which means less people may have looked at them. And if less people looked at them, that increases the chance that inconsistent data might have passed. Filter, like one person looked at it, the average deviation would be zero, so it would make it past the filter. So that's a possible explanation as to why that the deeper Z's deviate from the model.
When you say deeper Z, does that mean the receiver location?
So this location right here.
Yeah.
Z's increases.
Okay, I guess I don't understand your explanation
then. Oh, no, I'm explaining. So my explanation isn't about physics, it's about actually like human error. So we had a list of the graphs and they were organized by Z depth.
Okay.
So the last graphs we analyzed were where Z was larger just because how the files were organized. And Craig actually left our project not quite at the end, but the last graphs only had two people looking at them, or might have had one.
Okay, I get
you. So you could have an average deviation of zero, but the data might have been bad. And so you could have a bad human estimate of when the fault was and made it to the filter.
Okay.
And then here at some points the graphs were really off significantly. So what channel is this?
This is
data is the preliminary indication of all threat. So very first graph you shown very coincided with the observed data and not shown the model of threat channel. If this was to be continued, we do expect another human analysis on the very original data of the very original observed data. So instead of just the three of us doing it by eye, we get more students and more people to do this by eye analysis and see what they get, and then cross reference that to back to the model and see if that works out. And the last thing we can do is change the actual index of refraction model itself. There's many that we have that was come to came up with.
Program takes the index refraction profile as an argument, so you could, so if you have like a list of index refraction profiles, it would go through and generate all the estimated graphs, and then you run that through the comparison to generate the comparison graph.
So, the difficult case of doing this, for me personally, is my misconstruction model is very crude, it didn't actually account for much curvature, and so I really had difficulty that, and then also adding on to getting math right finishing off. Differing initial formats, as I said before, Cole, Craig, and I all went through a by eye and wrote down the data, but we all had different formats of how to write down the data and different solutions. Cole had to deal with most of it, and I had to deal with lots of it, mapping the models, and the unorganized data. We all joined our data to one big Google sheet and touch sheet. So we had a large amount of this front and the other through a whole bunch of things.
And then the challenges I had, my initial time model, I was using the wrong formula. So initially when we were looking at graphs, the model, they didn't, like the differences didn't line up, and we're wondering why. My original coding of the model was wrong, so we generated a lot of graphs that weren't correct. And then the development of the code that actually made those comparison graphs, the original version required that you had this same number of data points from the model and that we observed, and that they had to be organized by the same channel number and dedef, so unnecessary amounts of time was I took unnecessary amounts of time to format all the input data that compares the graph, the comparison program. But now the modern version of the comparison program will take a model input of any length, a observed data of any length, and then create the comparison. So you don't need to spend time formatting it or anything. You just pick in whatever you have.
So when you were looking at the differences of time, use the start of the pulse, the peak, or the end?
Yeah, the start of the pulse, when the pulse arrives.
Okay. And how does your code work? Like, do you have a refraction, refractive index model that you use, and then how do you make a prediction, like what happens after?
For a constant index of refraction medium, the time is given by the distance you're traveling through that medium divided by c divided by n, the function that's equal to dn over c. But the index of refraction of Antarctic ice isn't constant, so I use the average value theorem to give an equivalent index of refraction for the d depths that are traveled by the pulse over the and that looks like this equation, and we have the distance that the light has traveled. So that will give us the time for each depth that we would expect whatever pulse is traveling.
It can also be that, like, the deviation that you're seeing might also be due to this, that since the index of refraction changes, and you're taking it to be a constant, like, by using the average, maybe some of the observations you made might have been right, but your predicted values are not.
Yeah.
No, they don't take any constant. The RT does in fact integrate over the entire path, but they assume a straight line.
this is actually an issue of, so these are only the data points that we agreed on. So there's few, so there's zero data points. For instance, this graph is only 4, which means for this channel, channel 9, Raphael, Craig, and I, the average deviation of our estimates was only less than 5 nanoseconds for these 4 Z depths. So this looks constant, but it's actually, we're just connecting the data points there.
Well, they're only 4, okay.
Yeah. The mark, the PowerPoint makes it hard to see the markers because it compresses the image. For the actual image, you can see markers where the data points are.
Okay, well, you can still, if I just take your 20 point, your 20 point will stay the same as your 100.
Yeah.
And one of the things that you worry about in a situation like this is that in whatever your data taking device is, that when you see a signal in one channel, it produces a signal artifact in another channel, which has exactly the same time. And what I'm wondering is whether or not, if you remember that with going through and scanning, if you remember cases where in multiple channels you saw exactly the same time.